Okay, we're starting. We are going to continue. Yes. Well, the radical x is the difference. Graph goes up. that's how we define increasing. So we have the function doing something like that, just moving up. So notice that here, if I call it x1 and x2, then f of x2 is here, f of x1 is here. It's increasing if my x value is larger than x2 is larger than this, then the y value here will be larger than that, because you're going up as you move from left to right. Pretty much this is what you're going to want to remember. I'm not going to ask you to repeat that. But yeah, you should be able to look at a graph and tell when something's increasing or decreasing, and we'll be able to find that more specifically algebraically later on. That's basically increasing, moving up as you go from left to right. Decreasing as you move back is the opposite. Going to be very important for us to find things like what we call interval of increasing and interval of decreasing. And so intervals are going to be important when these things are happening. So let's use some examples here. Notice that the function y equals x cubed. Everywhere along its domain, it is always going to be true that if you move from x going from left to right, your y values will keep getting higher. That's what x cubed looks like. As you move from left to right, your graph keeps going up. It's an increasing function, and we can say it's increasing in general. This is true everywhere on its domain. If I look at y equals x squared, however, I can't say it's increasing. Technically, this is neither. Right? However, depending on the interval I'm looking at, it can do one or the other. Right? So Where would it be increasing here? Can you tell me in general?
From 0 to infinity.
Alright, so here's from 0 moving on over there. So if we're looking at this half, it goes up as we move from left to right. Mm-hmm. But if I look at this half, it goes down as I move from left to right. So here, this one is increasing on, I could say, 0 to infinity, but it's decreasing. At 0, I don't say it's doing anything. On 0, it's kind of flat, right? So we say it's neither increasing nor decreasing. At x equals 0, it's doing neither. Right? So in general, I can't say it's an increasing function or I can't say it's a decreasing function, but if I restrict my intervals, I can say it's increasing on this interval, it's decreasing on that interval. I can look at the different parts of the function and see what the different parts are doing. Why that's important will be made clear a lot later. Well, not a lot, maybe in chapter 2. Just understand this idea of increasing and decreasing, and you will be fine. One more example, just looking at the picture. So for that function, tell me where it's increasing.
Yeah, 3, negative 1.
Yeah. No, negative 3 to negative 1.
Negative 3 to negative 1?
Negative,
negative infinity. Right, notice that even after negative 3 over here, it's still increasing. Right, so that's definitely one part. Negative infinity to negative 1.
And that's 2 potentially.
And here we're going to put a union, because we can be in either or. And from here, from 2 to infinity. Right? These arrows keep telling you that it keeps going up and this keeps going down. And what about decreasing?
Negative 1
to 2. Right? In this whole region between negative 1 and 2, I go down as I move from left to right. At negative 1 and at 2, we're not really doing anything. We're kind of horizontal. We're not really going up or going down. And we'll talk about what those mean, how we can actually discover those points later. That's, again, in chapter 2. There are very few functions where we can tell that in general. For like example, quadratics, I can tell you when a quadratic is increasing or decreasing pretty easily, and I can tell you where the high point or the low point is because that's the vertex. But for a general function, there's no general formula. So we'll have to talk about that later. But for now, just the idea of what it means, and we're going to be applying interpretations to these pretty soon. What else? That I put in section 1.1, finally. I wrote on section 1.2, where we're going to talk about combining and transforming functions. Transformation of functions. Basically, I'm going to talk about function composition and shifting and all that stuff. It's we've actually done some of this before in this class. And it's here. We're going to talk about function composition. Again, like I said, just going to mention it, not going to go into great detail. Transformations of functions. How you're going to want to think of function composition is basically plugging one function into the other, right? So I'm talking about the f of g of x and all that sort of stuff. Means and ranges have to match up and they have to kind of work nicely together. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. Yeah, for the rest of chapter one, I'm going to be throwing ideas at you pretty quickly, but just stop me if you have a question. We'll probably slow down a little bit when we hit logarithms, but for the most part, I'm just going to say, hey, remember this, remember this, remember that. This is kind of what we're doing. So let's talk about terminology and notation. Suppose. So basically what we're looking at is that means the mapping diagram to noise ranges. There's sets A, B, and C. These are just sets of numbers or elements. Now the function G has domain A and codomain B. So G is going to take elements from this set and put them in that set. Right? It's going to assign elements in that set. This is what the function G is. F takes elements in this set and assigns them to elements in that set. F does. It relates elements in B and C. G relates elements in A and B. So now we have three groups of things that we're keeping our eyes on. It turns out that we have a mechanism mathematically and algebraically to actually cut out the middleman. We can go straight from A to C, right? And I can track someone who starts here, ends here, and then where he goes. Now that combination is the composition function. That function is in fact what we would call g of f. So that's what I'm going to explain. That's the composition. It cuts down our work, cuts down our calculations by giving us a new, nicer function that cuts out all the middle steps. And you can keep going here. You could have tons of sets and you just have one function that goes from the beginning all the way to the end. So that's why this is really important. As well as when we get to chapter 2, we're going to deal with composition functions very differently in terms of derivative and such. So just to mention that. Function. F. This is how we might call it. F composed with G. Or F of G is how we call it. This topic is familiar to everyone. Is there anyone who never seen it before? Alright, so let's start with f of g. How would you describe that?
Two x what?
Right. So this, let me write it out and I'll jump there. So this you think of as this. So the g is plugged into the f, pretty much means wherever you see an x in this guy, you're going to put this function. So you can have something like, it's going to be g of x squared plus 1, which as you guys said, is 2x plus 4 squared plus 1. You're going to take this function and come in for x in that function. Right? It's the same idea with the difference quotient where we had f of x plus h. We literally took the function x plus h and we plugged it into the function f. We created a composition. Now you can expand this and simplify if you want, but I don't think there's not much benefit. See what would happen is we took f of f of f. So this was basically f of. I took f and put into f, and I would have gotten x squared plus 1, x squared plus 1. Then I'm going to take that whole thing and plug into x again. So I'm going to have x squared plus 1, squared plus 1, squared. And if you're so inclined, you can multiply that by this. Just wanted you to get the idea of plugging one thing into the other. And the picture that I gave you kind of tells you what you're doing. You're cutting out the middleman. So you can just, instead of having to compute outputs three different times, you just compute this function, you simplify once, and then you can just jump from one to the other in one computation. There's one important notion that we're going to do later. And it's going to be decomposing functions. Now it turns out that this isn't unique. We tend to do this in the obvious way. is identify the inside function. Simple functions to work with. It's not really unique, but it's something that you can get practice on. In f of g of x, it requires you to identify an inside and an outside function. It's pretty much trying to go in the opposite way of doing the composition. It sounds a lot more scary than it actually is, so let me just show you that. Because it'll kind of be obvious, or usually. Decompose. Into functions. F and G. Or I'm thinking of G as the inside. F I'm going to press the outside, and here's the function. Yes. Give an example here. So it's 2 plus 1, 2 plus 4. First one?
G of x is 2x squared plus 1.
Right, so you look at this thing, you kind of look for an inside function, something that's plugged into something else. Well, clearly here you see the parentheses and this 3. To have this whole thing cubed is kind of weird, kind of sticking out at you. It's not just x cubed, it's the whole thing cubed. That kind of jumps out at you, so you're like, this thing here is on the inside of a cube. So let's take that to be the inside function. 2x squared plus 1. And the outside would be what?
x cubed plus 4.
So notice that you're going backwards. I know that if I took this and plugged it into here, I would have gotten that. Right? So you see you're kind of going backwards. But first you identify who's on the inside, you take it out, and then you put an x in its place to get the outside function. What about in part B?
G of x is?
6 squared.
I take x squared plus 7. F of x
is
just radical x. So notice that if I took this function, plug into that function, I would have gotten that function. I'm kind of going backwards.
Do you have multiple answers?
There are multiple answers. So that's why I said we kind of do it in the obvious way. It's not unique. You could actually do something which is kind of silly and just cheat. You could just say, g of x is x, and f was exactly what it was before, and that would still technically be correct. It's not very useful. The function is still as complicated as it was before. The idea is I want to go from this to something simpler. Break it into two parts, and kind of the obvious way, you can clearly see who's inside the brackets or inside a radical or something similar. How do you break up part C? And this is just 5 over x. So it's kind of going backwards from reverse a composition. Right now we're not going to do much of that, but we will come back to using this idea when we get to derivatives and talk about the chain rule. So that's function composition and decomposition. Everyone kind of seems to get that, so move on. Something else that hopefully is familiar, transformations of functions. Not going to spend too much time here. It'll help you with graphing. Where will we do with graphing? We'll have another system in place anyway, but just to mention that. Could skip it. Talking about how functions change based on certain operations that you can do within the function itself. So for example, given a function x, so technically a transformation is just something that you can do to the picture, right? It's a stretch or a shrink or a rotation or something like that. But there are some that are really important in algebraic calculus. So for example, if I were to say f of minus x, what does that actually do? Reflect where?
Y.
It's reflection in the y-axis. So, for example, my function is this. This is f of x. Then f of minus x is that. Right? Within the y-axis. What about minus f of x? This is reflecting the x. You can point a specific example here. This is f of x equals x cubed, and this is f of minus x would be the negative of x cubed. Flip in the x-axis, so something like if that's your f of x equals x squared, then I can flip upside down. I flip it in the x-axis, this function is the negative of f of x, which is the negative of x. So if you negate all the x's, what that does is it flips in the y-axis. If you negate the whole function as a whole, you actually flip in the x-axis. So those are two kinds of transformations. Those are called reflections. There are a lot of other ones like translations and shifts, which we know. Basically, it'll help us figure out graphs easier. Once we know the basic graphs of our functions, we can graph more complicated things without too much trouble or many more computations.
So I have something like f of x minus c. C is a positive number. What does that mean?
It's a shift to the right by g.
Right? Shift to the right by c units. So I could have something like this. Again, I have my f of x equals x squared, and I could do here f of x minus 1, say, would be x minus 1 squared, and so what's going to happen is that graph's going to shift over here. It's the same graph, but it's just shifted one unit to the right. X plus c, same idea, this is a shift to the left. Those are called reflections. One thing is, when it happens inside of the bracket, it kind of happens counterintuitively. So notice that when you subtract the c, you don't move to the left as might be intuitive, you move to the right. So the thing is, when you're in the brackets, you might think like if this is a 5 or a 3 or something, you would think it would be a stretch, but when it's inside, it's actually a shrink, because your x has to start shrinking to compensate for the extra factor. So this is actually a shrink. This shrinks horizontally. Factor of C.
doesn't have to be symmetric. So this is my f of x. Then my f of x over 3 would go from minus 9 to 9. Are called the horizontal stretches and fringes. Vertical similar, C f of x. C greater than 1 is a vertical stretch. Stretches, shrinkages, reflections.
I think that's all.
And that was 1.2. So 1.2 talked about changing functions based on composition, plugging one function into. Oh, no, we have to talk about operations. Not much to mention here either, actually. Operate on functions just as you would numbers, so we can add them together, subtract them, multiply them all and stuff. So we can actually define f plus g of x to just be adding all the y values. Or f minus g of x to subtracting the function. G of x just needs multiplying them. F over G of X.
of x is non-zero, you never divide by zero. Okay, so when you combine these two functions, now we're looking at the domain of those functions. Look at the individual functions first, figure out the domain of each one, and then look at the combination, figure out the domain of that combination. And that is the domain of the function. So for example, that x equals
now you look at where all of these three intersect.
these lines are here, but you can't touch the zero because there's a hole. There's a similar rule for function compositions. By assumption, all the outputs of G will be in the domain of F, so we don't really have to care about the domain of F. But we do have to care about the domain of G. So let me throw an example there. So say that F of X was 1 over 2 of X squared plus 4. G of X was radical X, and I look at F of G of X, what would that be? Cube root, we can be positive or negative, right? So that won't matter. But we can't be zero because it's in the denominator. So from this, it looks like x cannot be -4. But the thing is that, remember, this wasn't the original function. This is a function that resulted from plugging this guy into that. But for this guy, I couldn't plug in negatives. So it means that in here, I can't plug in negatives either. Because I'm using this here. So the idea is, for the domain of G, I need it to be zero or bigger. And so now, in other words, x cannot be negative. And so for the domain of f, for this guy, I know that x cannot be, but I have to take the intersection of these two. So that means, what does that mean? X greater than 0 and x not equals 4, -4, what would that look like? That on a number line, 0 is here, and that way, that's greater than 0. But I cannot touch negative 4. So the domain is just still that way. The intersection is still 0. So the domain of the whole function would just be from 0 to infinity. Now I can bring down the function. Of lines, but we are going to talk about some new interpretations of them. So, you might hear the term a linear function. So, if I say that phrase, a linear function, as the form. Because it has a slope and an intercept, it's called the slope-intercept form. Intercept form of the equation of the line. Graphs of linear functions. Is going to be a straight line, they would be non-vertical. Side note, a vertical line has the form. What does the vertical line look like? The equation. X equals something, right? X equals a constant. And it is not a function. Because you have the same input giving you, going for different outputs. Right? So a non-vertical line. So here,
So if you have y equals n x plus b, there are several options that you can have. You can have what's called a horizontal line. You can have an increasing line. Line with increasing slope. You can have a line with decreasing slope. So here you can say slope equals zero. This means you're horizontal. And so your equation is just y equals some constant, where that constant is working past through here. Here, we call the slope. What do we say the slope here? It's positive. Here, we say the slope is negative. Y equals mx plus b, one of those options are going to be true. It's either going to be horizontal, it's going to be going down with you from left to right, or up with you from left to right, and it will be a straight line. And this is by definition. Rise over run. Rise is the vertical distance you move, run is the horizontal distance you move over the same interval. And the larger this number is, the steeper it is. Which in this case would be equal to, and this is the form that everyone can say they're steep. Y2 minus y1 over x2. Minus x1. Right, this is just the difference in these points. So this here has y values y1 and y2. So the vertical distance you would have moved would be y2 minus y1. this here as x1, x2. The horizontal distance would have been equal to x2 minus x2 minus x2. So that gives us the slope problem.
Logarithmic is going to be the next topic.